Hello and welcome again to this edition of Fi TV, a product of Florida Internet and Television, the industry that connects and entertains over 95% of all Floridians. I am joined by Frank Walker of the Florida Chamber, and I'm Brad Swanson, your host. Frank, thanks for coming back on.
Hey, appreciate the opportunity to be here, Brad.
All right, so we're in the midst of the Florida legislative session, but before we begin, the Florida Chamber of Commerce is a big organization. Tell us what you guys do.
Sure. So our primary purpose is to unite the business community for good towards some very specific goals with the overarching goal of becoming a top 10 global economy in the world by 2030. Right now, if Florida was its own country, our GDP would rank us 16th in the entire world. So bigger than Saudi Arabia, bigger than Turkey, and we're trying to get to that top 10 spot. Our foundation, one of our arms of the military, if you will, sets out goals over the next 10 years that we need to make progress towards to get to that top 10 economy. The chamber itself proper has an advocacy arm that I lead. We make progress on those goals on a two-year time frame. Today, over the course of the next two legislative sessions. And of course, we have a political arm as well that I lead that engages in political action and electioneering and in direct support to candidates so that we have the right people on the field to make the right policy happen.
Well, and you know, having been both a member of the organization, a former employee, I mean, it's big and it's a lot. And when you're leading those two divisions of the chamber, it's huge. So you mentioned the political angle. I know the elections weren't yesterday, but they're recent enough to still be playing a huge role in True. This legislative session. Talk and beyond. So talk to us a little bit about your key takeaways from the last election and where you see maybe that's gonna play out more for the next one.
Sure. So historic election in Florida, largest margin of victory for Republican governor since Reconstruction. 19 plus points, so big mandate for the governor and his legislative agenda over session, but it also resulted in supermajorities for the House and the Senate. 84 members in the House, 28 in the Senate. I think that those supermajorities are here to stay, and part of that is because of massive changes in voter registration over the last 2 years. Over the last 2 years, you've seen a net 500,000 voter increase to Republicans from Democrats.
Huge.
Massive change.
Right.
Big movement also around Hispanics registering, more likely to register Republican for the first time in modern history. But still, that biggest growing group, which is going to be the wild card moving forward, is MPAs.
Well, let's talk about the Hispanics before we move on to the MPAs. You know, traditionally, or at least not traditionally, but for the last 20 years, the arguments on national media was always, oh, the Hispanics, you know, are lean more left than they do right. You're saying they're the new ones or the ones that are registering are leaning more right?
So new registrations are breaking Republican in the Hispanic demographic. And frankly, we saw that play out in a lot of elections this past cycle, down in Miami-Dade, Osceola County, in the I-4 corridor, where typically you would say, you know, a Republican candidate probably doesn't have an opportunity there based on the demographics of the district. That didn't play out that way this year.
Well, no one's doing more research on the granularity of districts and trends and things like that. And then we also know that nobody is able to project like the chamber can for its business members. Your board is a who's who of both small and large businesses across the state and the major economies. What forecasting or what do you guys see down the road for that 2024? We know there's a lot of eyes on the presidential election, but just in general, what are you seeing?
Sure. So if you look at the Senate map, there's really only one particular seat in play. It's here in Tallahassee, Corey Simon's seat, recently elected senator. Joining that Republican majority. I think that's really the only offense opportunity that the Democratic caucus has. So that supermajority in the Senate is probably here to stay for the near term. Some big pickups for the House on their map, where I think they're going to be playing a little bit more defense. But again, those supermajorities are here for the short term, at least. In the House as well.
All right. Well, now because they've got those supermajorities, let's flip over to that. And we'll do a little analysis on the chambers and the governor's mansion. You know, in years past, those were three very different entities, if you will, that had their own agendas that they typically had to match. I would argue just by what I've been seeing and the folks that we've been talking to on Fi TV is that they're very aligned, probably more aligned than we've seen in a long time. What's the chamber seeing? It's not just in relation to your business agenda, but just the philosophies that you're seeing over there.
Sure. I mean, in the past, we've seen not necessarily sparring partners, but I wouldn't call them dance partners either between the House and the Senate. Really, what we're looking at moving into the 2024-2023 session is dance partners in Kathleen Pasademo as the Senate President, House Speaker Paul Renner. When you saw their opening day remarks, they talked about each other's agenda as much as they did their own. And I think that's because there's a lot of overlap, there's a lot of shared philosophy, and there's also a mutual want to see the governor's agenda be successful as well.
Yeah, and that's, I mean, that's a very interesting thing, because even when you had, you know, Governor Scott and even Governor Bush, you know, when they would lean in, their agendas, and I'm not going to say anyone's agenda is a given, but nothing was a given. And it seems that the collective agenda, it is on the march. And it doesn't seem that the gamesmanship, if you will, of going, okay, that key facet of that bill, we're going to hold that back in our our agenda before, you're just not seeing that. Like, stuff's been solved before we even got to the first day.
Sure. I mean, long way to go in a 60-day session, obviously. And the budget makes things interesting as we get down to the nitty-gritty. But I think there's a lot of mutual want to keep Florida's momentum going. Florida has really kind of become the epicenter of the national conversation, and that blueprint for Florida's economic momentum is trying to be replicated around the country, and I think there's a lot of buy-in from leaders to keep that momentum and keep our progress.
All right, let's talk about the Florida scorecard for a second, because we know Frank Walker gets judged on that Florida scorecard, and this year we think the Florida scorecard could potentially shift some things from yellow to green, and specifically we're going to start on the issue of legal reform, which is humongous. It's one the chamber has always been out front on. We see now a collective march on many issues in that realm. Give us the background and give us where we're going. Tell us where we're going.
So, like I was saying, Florida's got a lot of momentum. We do a lot of things right, from our tax climate, our fiscal discipline, our regulatory climate, our geographic advantage, the fact that we're leading the nation in business formation and startups, the fact that we're leading the nation in net migration and wealth migration. $1.27 million is moving here every single hour. 1,000 people are moving here every single day. Florida has a lot of things in the positive column on its side. The one anchor holding us back from reaching our competitive potential as a state has been our legal climate. We're ranked in the bottom five nationally. We've been defined as a judicial hellhole. That's not a label anyone who does business in Florida
for a long time.
And frankly, it's not hard to see why. I mean, if you drive down a road that's got pavement on it, you've probably seen a billboard encouraging you to sue someone to get a quick payday. I think that we've got legislative leaders and a governor and a united business community that is at the point of saying enough is enough, and we need some common sense reforms to rebalance the scales of our civil justice system.
Where are we ranked in as far as against our other states? Remind me, is it 47th? Is it 46th?
We're 46th right now, okay. And I think that, you know, that's the product of really the status quo being perpetuated over the last decade to 15 years in Florida. The good news is our legislative leaders, our bill sponsors for some very significant reform this year, and a united business community behind it have an opportunity to bring some sanity to the civil justice system. Well, not block access to the courts, not say that folks shouldn't have access to justice, but simply say, you know, the litigation abuse that's costing Florida families over $5,000 a year in increased cost of goods and services, that's an affordability issue that can't continue.
Yeah, you can run that math over 21 million, 22 million, where are we at right now? But you think about it, right? So we think about it from the business perspective, obviously being in that world of advocacy. So you're 46th worth, but if you're in the business suing business, we're fourth best. Right. So they're like, we love Florida. That's not the type of economic development we want in Florida, correct?
It certainly isn't. And you think about the waste. So our economy is a $1.4 trillion economy. I talked at the beginning about how we're the 16th largest economy in the world. 3.6% of that economy goes to tort cost. That's almost $50 billion a year, more than we spend on education in this state, more than we spend on infrastructure in this state combined.
Wow.
So we've got to, if we're going to continue our momentum towards that 10th largest economy, rein this system in and tamp down some of those costs.
Just finding balance and making it fair. And right now, it's definitely tipped in one direction. Okay, so let's move on to the next of one of the favorite Florida Chamber issues, which is housing and workforce. And really, workforce sits on the top of that. Your six pillars. Anyone that's been involved in Florida advocacy has seen this brilliant way to kind of analyze and take on the entirety of the lexicon of advocacy. Let's start with workforce and then go into housing.
So on the workforce front, it's a competitiveness issue as well. Florida does not have an unemployment problem. We have a talent gap in Florida. Far more open jobs looking for people than people looking for jobs in Florida. What that tells me is that, frankly, those looking for jobs don't have the skills that current employers need. This all starts at the very beginning of the educational process, though. We track third grade reading scores very closely, as you know, Brad, being a Chamber alum. And unfortunately, 53% of Florida's third graders are able to read on grade level. That means almost half are not. That's the nexus of when you go from learning to read to reading to learn. Right. If we're not doing that right, the opportunities those children will have to enter the workforce eventually and be contributing members to not only the workforce, but the economy and society as a whole, it's greatly diminished. So we're going to see some early childhood education and K-12 efforts to ensure that those opportunities for children to reach their full potential are more available to every family regardless of the zip code they live in. And we're also going to see some efforts to ensure parents know that there's more than one pathway to success for their children.
Yeah.
Everybody doesn't need to go to one of Florida's renowned, number one in the country higher education institutions. There's also technical and certification opportunities. There's pre-apprenticeships, apprenticeships, work-based learning, and I think we need to fill all of those lanes if we're going to fill that talent gap over time.
Well, I mean, Frank, oddly enough, we're getting close on time here, but when you think about the breadth of the Chamber agenda, we're going to have you come back on and talk about the other pieces, but give me a little bit of a speed round before I'm going to ask you a little fun question when we're done here. Top two other issues that the Chamber's focused on, and I know there's more, but give us two more.
You mentioned housing, and when we travel around the state, and we do constantly, whether it's talking with all of our local Chamber members or businesses from Key West to Perdido Key, and everywhere in between, every size, sector, region, housing is continuing to be a problem, and it's a workforce problem as well. If employees can't afford to live where they work, that becomes a competitiveness issue for job attraction. So we're going to see some pretty important legislation on attainable workforce housing this year, kind of an all-of-the-above approach. And then our insurance market drives the housing situation that we have as well. Thankfully, the legislature took some big steps that the Chamber was supportive of in special sessions this past year to try and drive down some of the cost drivers that are causing homeowners insurance premiums to go up. And that's a huge component of that workforce competitiveness issue as well.
Well, Frank, in our closing minutes here, thanks to you, thanks to the Chamber for not just fighting for Florida's businesses, but for all the employees in those businesses, for the things that need to change in the economy to make our economy thrive. And we know it's a tireless group over there. And we know the employees and the team over there doesn't get enough credit for the amazing work that you guys do. So as a member of the Florida Chamber, we're grateful for what you guys do. And we look for your leadership on those issues and more.
Well, Brad, we're only as strong as our members. We appreciate your support and FIT's support. We've got a great membership base that's all in for Florida, and we've got something worth fighting for.
How does somebody sign up?
So sign up, fwalker@flchamber.com. No, I'm just kidding. Call the Chamber and let us talk to you about how we can get you involved.
FlchamberFLChamber.com?
FLChamber.com. More than anything, we have to unite the business community around these issues and these goals so that we reach our true potential.
Thanks for coming on, Frank.
Great. Thanks for having me.
That's all the time we have for this episode of FI TV. For more interviews just like this one, make sure you hit us up on our social media feeds. And for now, thanks for tuning in.